It is a tremendous pleasure for me to have the opportunity to introduce our keynote speaker. About 18 months ago, I had the opportunity to attend one of the most interesting conferences that I had ever been to. It was 3 days in Chicago, and it was organized by a group called IEG. No matter what part of the world you're from, I recommend you go to sponsorship.com and you check out this conference. Actually, Charlotte was there with me. It was 3 days of stacked, fabulous information and keynotes. But one of the keynotes struck me because her presentation was so compelling, her delivery was so energetic, and the information was so timely and relevant. And I couldn't wait, and that was before I ever worked at headquarters, to bring this person to us in this audience. Our keynote is actually the Senior Vice President of Global Sparkling Brand Center, Coca-Cola. She's compelling, she's energetic, and she's intelligent. She's responsible for the global leadership of Coca-Cola's sparkling brands and businesses. She oversees brand strategy and integrated marketing communications. Her team has a leading voice on evolved consumer engagement under their Liquid and Linked program. Liquid and Linked program. We all got liquid this morning. Communication strategy. So she's highly recognized in many well-known circles. She's received many awards. I won't go into them in detail because we'd be here forever, but she is truly recognized as a leader in her industry. Ladies and gentlemen, Wendy Clark, Coca-Cola.
Good morning. Do not make me roll out the energizing refreshment Coca-Cola, because I will give every one of you a Coca-Cola if you don't bring the energy this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
That's a World Trade Center Association welcome. Thank you for having me, Bella, wherever you went. Thank you for the very kind introduction. I'm delighted to be here today to share with you a little bit about what Coca-Cola has been up to and some of our journey. And it is certainly a journey. It's not complete yet. We've got lots more to do. I'm going to share a few of the lessons and learnings we had. I start all of my presentations off with the same quote. And this is a quote from a woman named Nilofer Merchant. She's a strategist and business consultant. And she says that today's successful leader has to do two things. You have to both manage the present and invent the future. And on its surface, that sounds obvious, right? We go, okay, well, I get it. I got to manage the present. I got to invent the future. But that sort of changes when we start defining and thinking about what this present looks like, right? So the present is, it's ever-changing, it's 24/7, it's always on, it's dynamic, right? It's all the brands, all the consumers, all the content, all the conversation, right? It's thorny, it's difficult. You're trying to get your arms around this thing called the present, and while you're doing that, you're supposed to be, you know, visioning where this is going, right? This is not an easy task to be successful in today's market. I don't think I have to convince anyone in the room today that the world has changed. I think the most important thing I would say is we have been talking for a number of years about the world will change. And I would stand here today and tell you I think it has changed. And I think we can call it and we can say it has changed. Well, what does that mean? Well, there's more content in the world than we can begin to fathom, right? Last year on its 7th birthday, YouTube announced that they were uploading 42 hours of content every minute of every day. 42 hours of content every minute, every day. That's just one place. That's just YouTube. I mean, imagine the volumes of content. What happens to that content? Well, it scales. It scales around the world instantly, horizontally around the world. For a company like mine, we're in 207 countries around the world. Scale is good. We call it productivity. We like that. And that's a good thing. It also spreads, right? It spreads vertically across so many communication endpoints now. We believe everything can communicate, right? So everything has some communication value now. So all this content, scale, spread, the new kicker is that happens in real time. There is no such thing as putting the toothpaste back in the tube. Once it's out, it's out. And here's the piece that really hurts our feelings as large, upstanding corporate citizens. The truth is irrelevant. It's my truth, it's your truth, it's her truth. We all have our own truths. Those truths are largely shaped by our social networks. And for companies, we kind of go, well, hang on a minute, that's not the truth. It doesn't matter, right? It doesn't matter. Truth is irrelevant. That hurts our feelings, right? What hurts our feelings more than that is everything I just mentioned, all this content, all this scale, all this spread happening in real time will happen whether any of us gets out of bed tomorrow morning or not. We are largely optional to this as marketers. That really hurts our feelings, right? This is our target, teens and young adults. They're an affable bunch. And not only are they comfortable in this environment, they know differently. I have three children. My oldest daughter is 11 years old. She's currently negotiating hard for that first mobile phone. And a couple of months ago, she said in frustration as she was trying to convince me to get her a mobile phone, "Well, Mommy, how old were you when you got a mobile phone?" And I said, 27. And the look on her face was, "I am not waiting until I am 27. Right, this is like getting your ears pierced. She, you know, it's the same conversation. She can't even imagine that there was a world without mobile phones. Right, so they're very comfortable in this. This is a picture from a focus group one of our agencies did with teens. This is a teen from Italy. This is the picture they drew. That's them on the stage. What do they want? They want bright lights. They want fame. They want money. They don't even know what they want. Look at the statement that goes with it. "I want a life in which I am the protagonist. I do not want a boring life." And in these same groups, these same teenagers will say to us, "When I put content into my social networks, I have a built-in expectation of what that content will generate in terms of likes, comments, shares. And if my content doesn't receive and meet my expectation," and they say this, "I feel like a personal failure." We cannot even begin to fathom this. I mean, we're not that old after all. But feeling like a personal failure because your photo didn't get enough likes? Are you joking? No, I'm not joking. And so when people say to me, "Wendy, I'm not sure there's a role for brands and companies in this social network landscape," I would offer you this. Because if we give consumers useful, compelling, interesting, share-worthy content that becomes currency for them in their social networks, you have now created a role for yourselves in these consumers' lives. Very important. So given all this, what are we going to do? Right? What are we going to do? At Coca-Cola, about 2 years ago, we developed, as Bella said, our liquid and linked marketing communications program. Why liquid and linked? Well, liquid because, as I said, as a company of such scale and magnitude, we want content to go as far as possible. That's a good thing. Productivity. That's great. But in so doing, if that content becomes detached, unlinked from our brand strategy, then it does us no good, right? Because the goal is not more content. Don't be confused. You hear a lot of companies and brands saying, we need more. There's a constant engine for more content. It's not more, it's more good, right? Consumers are exposed to over 6,000 brand impressions daily on average. They don't need more content. They need more good, useful, interesting, compelling, share-worthy content that creates a currency of success for them in their social networks. So while these two feel antithetical, really liquid, uncontrollable, spreading, really deeply linked, it is by definition because we only want content to spread that is on brand strategy. There are three main areas to our liquid and linked agenda. The first thing we talk about is stories. Story is a big word for us. We use it to mean all brand content, all brand conversation, all brand experiences. What do we want to do with those stories? Well, we want them to spread through owned, earned, shared, and paid media. Owned media, we have 15 million pieces of equipment around the world. That's not a depreciating asset. That's a hardworking medium. Same for delivery vehicles and trucks. We have a bigger fleet than UPS and FedEx combined. That's hardworking media. Those aren't depreciating assets. Rethink the stuff you own. They can all carry messages for you. It can all communicate, and you already own it. The most controversial thing I say is that our 770,000 system associates are owned media. But they are. The very best storytellers you have in your companies are your employees. They are the most authentic storytellers you have. Owned, earned as PR, shared for us, the reality of our brands comes to life in an environment we don't control. In a restaurant, in a C-store, in a bodega, in a Walmart, right? So we have to partner with those partners to bring that to life. And then paid with social at the heart. A lot is made of social. We spend a lot of time talking about social today. It's important. It is not a silver bullet. You can do social perfectly and not meet your goals. But social makes everything else you do better. It is an incredible, significant amplifier, and it's really important that we get it right, but don't get it right at the cost of doing everything else you need to do right also. So stories that spread to do create value. Obviously, all of us are paid to create value for our brands, for our companies. In Coca-Cola, we would measure that in terms of brand love and brand value, enduring currencies of success. But it is no longer acceptable for brands and companies our size to simply create value for themselves. Society will not accept that. So we must create a value that transcends our own value, that creates value for our partners, for our supply chain, and the communities in which we operate, and indeed for the world, a shared value. So those are the three aspects of Liquid and Link. Today, I'm going to share with you five learnings. We've had 500, but I'm going to share with you five learnings that we've had on this journey. I heard a quote recently that said, if you can't say what you're trying to do in a hashtag, you have not made it simple enough. So here are my five learnings. First one we're going to talk about is the most important thing. If you do nothing else in your marketing, be shareworthy. In a socially networked world that we just talked about, it's not about the initial audience you can reach. It's about the audience they can reach for you by sharing your content. It is absolutely the hallmark of a socially networked world. So when you're looking at work, if you don't think it will have a life beyond the initial audience you can reach, it's not good enough. It must be shareworthy. You're not taking advantage of the landscape if you don't have work that can have a life beyond where you put it and get passed and shared along. I'm going to show you a piece of content now that our Latin America group did. This is called Security Cameras. I'm going to give the guys in the back, they've got to flip over to a different computer to show the film. Thank you. So a lovely piece of work, deeply on strategy. Coca-Cola is all about a moment of happiness, right? And what if every security camera looked through a happiness lens? and saw the positive side of the world, right? So liquid content that got shared, that's just one translation. We got them in all sorts of languages. So a total of probably 10 million views on that content. And that's the kind of content we should be putting out there. Now, as I said, it's not about the initial audience you can reach. We are very fortunate enough to be the largest brand fan page on Facebook. We have 73,409,136 fans as of 7:15 a.m. when I checked this morning. And we're the largest, although Facebook is larger than we are, which I think is largely cheating to have your own fan page. But we'll rest that aside for a second. But it is actually not about the 73 million. It is about the 73 million. But our business, we serve 1.8 billion beverages every day around the world. It's a big number. And Facebook has 1.2, they're a bit cagey about their numbers, 1.2 billion people, members on Facebook. So our 73 million are just over one fan or friend away from the full universe of Facebook. So within their reach, if you took our fans and their friends, it's pretty much the entire universe of Facebook. So, back to the principle of being shareworthy. If we develop useful, interesting, shareworthy, compelling content that consumers want to share, 73 million reach 1.2 billion for me, right? It's not about the audience I can reach, it's about the audience they can reach. Right? And that's why the number one thing you have to do is be shareworthy, right? Reach that ultimate audience with something so compelling that the people you can reach want to share it for you. The second learning, I would say, is this notion of embracing your new sales force. Who are your new sales force? Those guys. That gets a little sensitive again when I call our fans and our consumers our sales force, but they are. They are your hand raisers. The people who have joined your communities, the people who follow your brands and your company are not forced to. It's optional to be in a community. If they didn't like you, they wouldn't be there. When we misstep, when we do the wrong thing in our communities, our disconnects go up by 4x. We know immediately when we have done something wrong. They vote with their feet. I'm gonna show you a 30-second clip now. This is from a woman we found. Her name is Jess Paul. She has a handle on YouTube. Her handle is Prue's Love. She developed this piece of content. She didn't ever send it to us. We found it, and after we saw it, we contacted her. So let's take a look at the film and we'll talk about it. Great story. I'm the head of marketing communications for the company. I had nothing to do with that. I should be made very nervous by Jess Paul, right? Do you think we got a letter, a phone call, a text, a smoke signal, anything for permission to use a $79 billion brand in Jess's video? Any attorneys in the room? Anyone see the world's most valuable music brand over her right shoulder, Abbey Road? I can't afford the rights on that film, right? She definitely can't. But no, we didn't hear from Jess Ball. The consumers are using your brand willfully and freely. The most nervous people in my building are the attorneys. Because the marketers are saying, give away the IP, it'll be fine, right? And there are huge lessons in this, right? This is our new sales force. They want to tell the stories of your brand. So we contacted Jess and we said, hey, Jess, that's a pretty good story. Let's go back to the picture from the McCann research. What does she want? She wants a bright light. She wants money. She wants money. The recognition alone that Coca-Cola would call her and recognize her film was amazing, right? She goes and makes more films, right? Amazing construct. Anyone know this guy? No. Everyone on my team knows this guy. His name is Joel Robison. He's a special education teacher from Canada. That's his Twitter handle, Boy Wonder Joel. And he's a photographer enthusiast, hobbyist. We found him because he was uploading beautiful pictures of Coca-Cola bottles and cans on Flickr. And so we reached out to him and we said, Joel, we really like your work and we'd really like to use it. And can we form a relationship? If one thing led to another, we asked him if he would curate our Flickr page for us. He did that for the cost of a new camera. Sounds good, right? And he double, tripled our following on Flickr because he's authentically a fan. He's a super fan. He knows our brand inside and out, right? It's completely authentic. So the next thing that happened was we just kicked off our FIFA 2014 activation. We take the trophy, the World Cup, around the world to 89 countries. And we needed a photographer. And we said, well, what if we asked Joel if he wanted to go on the trip of a lifetime to 89 countries with us to capture photographs? And so we said, hey, Joel, you want to go on the trophy tour? How about if you run our Twitter handle? How about if you authentically talk about the experiences of consumers seeing the World Cup up close and you take pictures, right? This is embracing your new sales force. Joel came out of his skin, imagine. So now Joel, that's what Joel's roadmap looks like. Joel is traveling with the trophy for the next year. We have divine blessing for this trophy tour. We kicked off in Rio. We will end in Rio. We'll go to 89 countries. We'll travel 92,000 miles. Over 1 million fans will see the trophy. Is it about the million fans who see the trophy? Have you been? Come on, are you with me? It's not about the million, is it? It's about who the million are connected to. That's a big number, a million people getting up close and having their picture with a trophy, but what are they going to do with that picture? A once-in-a-lifetime experience that is shareworthy, interesting, useful, compelling content that goes further than the million that I reach, right? It's the core construct of what we're doing. And these are the type of photos that Joel is taking, these beautiful celebratory pictures of people so happy. Look at this guy. He's looking at his photo. I can't believe it. I had my photo with the World Cup. Which brings us to the next principle. In a real-time, socially connected world, speed trumps perfection. This is really hard for marketers. We have made a career of being perfectionists. We work on the last 5% as hard as we worked on the first 95%. We're control freaks, admit it. If your content is perfect, it doesn't matter if you miss the context. Everyone familiar with the Oreo dunk in the dark? If they had put out the dunk in the dark tweet the next day, it wouldn't have made sense. You've got to move in real time, right? So we got to get the lighting on the cookie just right. Okay, we'll do dunk in the dark the next day. Doesn't make any sense. You have to be contextually relevant. At Facebook, they say done is better than perfection. Done is better than perfect. Done is better than perfect. Here's another picture that Joel took. Again, lovely pictures he's capturing around the world. We take them, we brand them, and we send them back out. Real fan stories from our photographer, send into our creative team, send them back out to 175 markets every day. Liquid content, deeply on strategy, right? These lovely, beautiful stories of football and the World Cup and happiness, perfect. Bam, 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 going out, real time. They're not perfect, they're not, you know, the lighting might not be perfect. Joel's down there doing his best, maybe this isn't quite perfect here with, you know, beyond the pitch, whatever. This is interesting, right? Compelling stuff. So, speed trumps perfection. We have opened real-time listening and engagement hubs around the world. There are up to 15,000 tweets every day on brand Coca-Cola. There's a conversation and a drumbeat on all of our brands, and you must be out there to engage. Consumers expect you to be there engaging, right? We have 8 millennials running our hub. The hipsters are taking over at Coca-Cola. Eight millennials, they have the keys to the castle. They are engaging in real time. Imagine. That's a big deal for a 127-year-old company, right? It's a big deal. Cultural change. And that's what we're really seeing in this landscape now. You have to break down the hierarchies in your company. You will not be able to move in real time. You know, if you got to go up five levels to get approval and back down, it's not going to work, right? You have to empower people, push empowerment down in your teams. You have to use the technology to know and see and understand what's going on in the marketplace. Measurement is real time. As I said, when we do something wrong, our disconnects go up by 4x. Bam, we know immediately we've done something wrong. And by the way, the measurement after every time we do something becomes the front end of the next decision, right? So take everything you learned and it fuels and informs your next decision. We get better and better and more precise as we go because we've got that measurement. And finally, the capability not to be underestimated. We have 2,700 marketers around the world at Coca-Cola. It's a big deal to try to get their capabilities where we need them to be, but we got to focus on that. The next learning I would tell you is this idea of being ambitious. If you are not ambitious for your brand, who will be? Right? You have to be ambitious. You absolutely have to be restless about taking your brand and maximizing all the benefit you can get for that. The thing that keeps me up at night is that we're not brave enough, that we're not innovating enough, that we've left some measure of innovation unexplored. And the way I know that is if we're not failing enough. If you're not failing, you're not innovating. You've left some measure of unexplored space between you and where the end point of innovation is. So we have to get better culturally at accepting failure. And that's difficult. We've all built careers on our successes, not on our failures. But it's okay to fail as long as you capture the learnings. If you don't capture the learnings, that's the failure, because then you might repeat the same failure. But you must be ambitious for your brands. You must push, you must be brave, you must try things, you must fail. We want to set the next, you know, the agenda on marketing. I don't want to do what everyone else is doing. I want to move it forward, right? Be ambitious for your brand. The final learning I would share is this idea of work that matters. And I think it's so important now, again, in the sea of content, that we're using our voice, our content that we're putting out into the world to, yes, certainly create goodness for ourselves, but also to create that shared value where we can use the content that creates goodness for ourselves to create a goodness that transcends us. I'm gonna show you this next film now that I really think hits the mark on work that matters. It really is emblematic, I think, of creating goodness for ourselves and for others. So take a look. This is Small World Machines.
The relationship between India and Pakistan is one that has seen a lot of lows.
It's stressful, it's tense.
It seems it's not improving and it's getting worse.
It's only been 60 years that we have been apart. Before that, we were living harmoniously together.
I think all the strife would go away if you took away the barbed wires in the middle of the two countries.
It saddens me that we have this neighbor that we can't even go visit.
They have this perception, which they've been drained in the head, that that's the bad guy. But when they actually meet them, they realize, you know what, he's just like me.
Mainly because there's no communication. They're near us, but we have no access to them. And it's sad. Because together, I think we would do wonders.
Thank you.
We're creating an environment where young people can exchange ideas, thoughts, gestures, and take away that communication gap that exists.
If I have any opportunity to go to India, I'll surely go there.
The whole idea of actually touching hands, it's like communicating with each other without words. And that action speaks louder than anything else.
It's like, this is what we are supposed to do, right? We are going to take minor steps so that we are going to solve bigger issues.
It is more about, you know, how similar we are as opposed to how different we are.
Togetherness, humanity, this is what we want. More and more exchange.
Ask me how proud I am to work for Coca-Cola. That is truly work that matters, right? Yes, that creates a goodness for our brands. 100%. I'm an unapologetic capitalist, don't get me wrong. But I'm also a capitalist for the world. I truly believe that all of us can use our position, our platform, to create goodness for our companies, our brands, but also for the world. And that's an example. So we don't believe that there can ever be a deconstruction between growth and goodness. We must do both. We must absolutely do both. So that's a quick canter through Liquid and Linked, right? It's about stories, brand experiences, conversations, content that spread through owned, earned, shared, and paid media with social at the heart to create a value, certainly a value for ourselves, but also a value that transcends our companies. Today we talked about five learnings. If you do nothing else, be shareworthy. Use your initial audience to reach an ultimate audience that is far greater than one you can reach by yourself. Embrace your new sales force. You give them the currency of conversation that creates value for them in their social networks. They're your hand raisers. They want to carry your stories. Speed trumps perfection. Done is better than perfect. We have to reimagine what is required to operate in a real-time world. Be ambitious. Be ambitious, unabashedly ambitious for your brands. If you don't, who will? And finally, create work that matters. Create work that creates value for you, but also that matters, that takes advantage of your platform, your position in the world, and creates a goodness. Thank you very much.